Well, thank you, President John, and it's my pleasure to introduce Dr. Rod Carr. And I've just picked a few interesting snippets out of his bio. The first one is that he did his PhD in insurance and risk management at Wharton in the United States. And very appropriate thing, he comes from Christchurch. he has been the chair of the Reserve Bank. He has been the deputy governor and for a time the acting governor of the Reserve Bank. He was the founding chair of the National Infrastructure Advisory Board, which is an institution set up by this government. He has been the vice chancellor of the University of Canterbury, my alma mater, for the last 10 years. And in sometime about September last year, he got a call from James Shaw, the Minister for Climate Change, to invite him to become the inaugural, the first chair of the Climate Change Commission, which was established in law under the Zero Carbon Act 2019. And amongst his onerous duties in that regard through the Climate Change Commission is to get us on track to deliver as a nation the target of net zero carbon emissions by 2050. And so it's really on that topic that we invited Rod to talk to us tonight, but also perhaps to reflect a bit on what life could be like in a COVID or post-COVID world in terms of the challenges around climate change. So I asked him if he wanted to use a PowerPoint, and he said no, he prefers to engage with the audience. So please welcome Rod Carr.
Ngā mana, ena iwi, tēnā koutou katoa. Kia ora, everybody. It's a privilege and a pleasure to be here and to take the opportunity to talk to you this evening. What I'm going to do briefly, and some of you will know some of what I'm going to say, but it's a kind of elevator pitch for climate action. First thing, little factoid to remember, is that we've known about the science of climate change since the 1850s. A woman scientist in the United States, Eunice Foote, conducted a series of experiments in which she put different types of gases into glass tubes and exposed them to sunlight to see what happened. And the tube full of carbon dioxide warmed up and stayed warm beyond other tubes filled of oxygen and nitrogen and other gases. She concluded from her observation that if one was to increase the amount of carbon dioxide in the air, it would have a blanketing effect on the planet. That was 1850s. In 1912, in New Zealand, in a local newspaper in Thames, there was an article talking about the fact that around that time, the world had mined 2 billion tons of coal and created 7 billion tons of carbon dioxide as a result of burning it. And again, highlighted the fact that known science suggested that in centuries to come, this might warm the planet. In the mid-1960s, petrochemical engineers provided a report to Lyndon Johnson that said, "We are terraforming. At the rate at which we are now burning fossil fuels in the atmosphere, we are changing, not we will change, we are changing the planet's temperature." Of course, Lyndon Johnson was busy with other things, wars in Vietnam and so forth, so not much got done. Then there was the talk about peak oil. Remember that? We were going to run out. Turned out not to be true either. It took until 1992 in the Framework Convention at the United Nations for the world to agree we have a problem and we need to do something about it. And it turns out that half of all the carbon dioxide in the atmosphere today has been emitted since 1980. We're currently emitting every year the equivalent of 600 medium-sized active volcanoes. That's what humankind is doing. So the world decided that decarbonisation was one of and a significant part of addressing the impact of greenhouse gases. Carbon dioxide is not the only gas that warms, but it is the one that accounts for 40 billion metric tons of emissions of the 55 billion metric tons emitted every year. So it is somewhat under, but only just 80% of the source of the problem. So New Zealand signed up to the United Nations Framework Convention, and we signed the Kyoto Protocol, and we emit more today than we did then. So we thought signing once is good, signing more is better, so we signed up for Paris with our nationally determined contributions, and under the Paris Agreement, along with some 196 other countries, we said we would adopt nationally determined contributions, which was the best, boldest effort that we thought we could make to put us on a pathway that would enable the world, the planet we live on, to try and maximize global temperature rises at 1.5 degrees centigrade above pre-industrial levels, for which 1850 is counted as the baseline. So it's really about 1850 that we got into the oil burning business and we got the mechanization for coal extraction and processing at scale. So, how are we going about it? What are we going to do? We've signed an international treaty that says we will reduce our emissions, and then we've signed up for a domestic definition of that, which is a two-gas world. We'll reduce our emissions of everything except biogenic methane, that's the methane produced by ruminant livestock. We will reduce all the other gas emissions to net zero effect on global warming by 2050. And we will reduce the biogenic methane by 24 to 47%. So that's in domestic legislation. Of course, any future government can change that target. It's only a domestic target. Our international treaty obligation under Paris is a little more difficult to wiggle out of. Why? Because as a small trading nation, you tear up treaties at some cost and consequence for the willingness of the world to believe that you'll abide by the next treaty you sign, or that they should enforce on your behalf the treaties over trade that you have already entered into. So there are real consequences for New Zealand in failing to meet both its domestic, but more importantly, its international obligations. Let me for a moment tell you about the work of the Climate Change Commission. The Commission itself is not all things climate change. We have quite a precisely focused mandate and the limited budget to go with it. The mandate is, please provide independent advice to the government of the day. So it's advice. We have no tools. We can set no prices. We can pass no regulations. We can prohibit no activity. We have no balance sheet to buy support or subsidize anything. We simply provide independent advice. Advice about how much carbon dioxide equivalents can we emit in order to be on a path to achieve our domestic targets and international obligations? And how much can we emit in five-year buckets, on the grounds that each and every year may be a little difficult to predict, but between now and 2025, what's our emissions budget? Between 25 and 30, what's our emissions budget? And between 2030 and 2035, what's our emission budget? The first three emissions budgets. And budgets are useless without a plan. So we need a plan to go, if that's the budget, how are we going to achieve it? And of course, the starting point is to say, well, where are we today? Now, we know from international standards for counting emissions that New Zealand's emissions are in the order of 80 million metric tons per annum of carbon dioxide equivalent. It's sort of 78 to 80, so rounding errors, keep the big number 80 in there. 80 million metric tons per annum, 5 million people, 16 tons for each and every one of us per capita. About half of that is agricultural emissions. So put that to one side and you've got 8 million tons. Per capita, per annum. And about half of that is transport, how we drive and get around. And a big chunk of what's left is how we create electricity. Because yes, we do create a lot of renewable power, but actually 15% of all the electricity is not from renewables. And that fluctuates from 15 to 20% is not from renewables. And we use a lot of coal and gas in industrial processes. So actually the challenge is pretty real. Now, one of the arguments that you hear is, but New Zealand's emissions are 0.17 of 1% of global emissions. It's not going to matter to the world whether we do anything or nothing. It's just going to cost us a lot of money. So why would we bother? We should spend all the money we have to spend on either protecting our infrastructure from rising tides and storms or replacing it further inland where it'll be safe. Well, here's some of the reasons why you need to actually buy into this game. The first one is that historically, we've emitted more than most countries. The Parliamentary Commissioner for the Environment estimated that the burning down of native bush to create pasture land emitted 3 billion tons of carbon dioxide into the atmosphere, a substantial proportion of which is still up there today. That's the equivalent of 40 years of gross emissions at the current rate. If you don't like the historical argument on the grounds we didn't know what we're doing, so we can't be held accountable, on a per capita basis, even excluding agriculture, our per capita emissions are nearly twice the average of humanity today. So you don't get a free pass by just saying, well, per capita, we're cool. Then there's the argument of, well, if little countries all get an exemption, the 100 smallest emitters contribute a third of all global emissions. So do they all get a pass? And then people point the bone at the United States. By the way, the US has reduced its greenhouse gas emissions by 15% since 1990. Just by the way. So before we point the bone at them, we need to think seriously about what are we saying when we say we don't want to play our part. On that basis, New Zealand should have never sent a single soldier to fight in anybody else's war because clearly it didn't make a difference. I don't buy that line for a minute. Further, if you want a seat at the table in the councils of the world to persuade the big guys to do better, you better arrive with clean hands and something to contribute, or you're not going to be invited in. And finally, it turns out it's not so much about what we can do to the world, it's what the world could do to us if we don't play the game according to global standards. Market access may become conditional on the contribution you make to dealing with this global problem. There's also an argument that half our emissions are because we feed the world. Well, we don't actually, we feed about 40 million people worth of dairy and meat protein. They happen to be the richest half of 1% of the world's population. And it happens to be that while we're an extremely efficient producer of dairy and meat protein from pastoral agriculture, emissions from other types of generating animal protein may prove to be lower sooner, because changing the diet of animals raised in barns turns out to be way easier than changing the biogenic methane emissions from pasture-raised animals. So there's a whole agenda here which is way more complicated than just we don't contribute much, so we don't have much to do, so we shouldn't do anything at all. We also have a sticky little problem that, having signed up to this treaty, when we fall short of meeting our 2030 target, we're supposed to go and buy credits to offset our failure from a global market of audited, credible carbon credits. Such a market does not exist. if it were to exist, it's likely to be made up of clubs of people that look like us, and that's likely to put a reasonable price on carbon abatement. So New Zealand can either choose to give the money to foreigners or invest it to make for a decarbonised economy sooner, one in which we may get ahead of some of the technologies and look for opportunities to show not only moral leadership, but technological leadership as well. So the Climate Change Commission is busy at work building the baseline or reference case that says this is where we think we are and this is what we think will happen if we don't do anything, and here's the size of the gap between our ambition, that is domestic targets and international obligations, and that gap needs to be closed by plans, and those plans mean changes to our behaviour. So the board of the commission also began to reflect on where does the evidence run out and where do judgments begin? What are the issues on which well-informed, evidence-based, rational people could simply reach different conclusions? Not about the science, but about the pathway to net zero for all but biogenic methane by 2050. One of those is around the pace at which you can reasonably expect in a Western liberal democracy to get change. If you try and do too much, too fast, and cannot carry the people with you, you may not get as far as you need to go ever. So the risk of waiting too long is it gets more expensive and harder to do more later. The risk of going too hard too soon is you alienate those who you need on your team in order to get stuff done. That becomes a judgment about politics and human behavior as much as about the science of sooner is better. Secondly, there is a challenging question about burdens. Who should bear the burdens of the transition? Not every loss can be compensated. Not every stranded asset is going to be purchased by the state, which means you and me. There are going to be uncompensated losses. Where should they lie? Who should be compensated if not everybody is able to be made whole? Should it fall to those who contributed most to the problem? Should it fall to those with the greatest of means? Should it fall to those who are going to get the greatest of benefits? Those questions are judgments. Judgments first by the Commission and its advice, and ultimately by our elected representatives as they make decisions. And an extrapolation of that is that conversation about, so what is New Zealand's fair share of a contribution, given our context and circumstance, our prosperity, our history? And there's no right answer and no evidence base for that. There's just judgment. What part should forestry play in removing carbon dioxide from our national contribution to global warming? We cannot plant our way out of this problem. We cannot continue to let gross emissions rise on the grounds we'll keep planting pine trees. Why can't we do that? Because ultimately you run out of land. Ultimately, you are one big carbon sink, but your communities are alienated and your social license for tree planting disappears, apart from which you're banking on a monoculture of pine trees that may burn down, get blown down, or become full of disease. So there's very good risk management reasons for going, some is good, but more is not always better. And what is the judgment about how much sequestration through Planus radiata plantations we should factor in and allow? So the judgments that the Commission needs to advise on will ultimately be decisions that our elected leaders have to make. And finally, I'm often asked by young people, so we're not decision makers, we're not policy analysts, we're not elected representatives, we're not big corporate leaders. We probably don't have very big emissions either because, you know, we don't have big budgets. What can we do? And there are three things which every one of us can do. The first thing is that every time we buy something off the shelf, we're signalling to the supply chain to make another one and put it back on the ship. So you will cause supply to meet your demand, and we get to vote every time we get to choose what we spend our money on. Secondly, we all have friends, we all have family, we have the opportunity to advocate in a calm but informed way. That the way this is fixed is by millions of people making thousands of choices. There are no great green cannonballs that are going to blow this problem to the smithereens. There's no single technology which is going to change the world. It is interesting that when we locked down the world and took the aircraft out of the skies, sent everybody home to work, global greenhouse gas emissions fell by 8%. Only 8%. Fossil fuels and fossil sources of energy are so deeply and widely embedded in what we produce, how we produce it, what we choose to consume, where we work, and how we live, that a global shutdown of that scale is needed each and every year for the next decade to have some prospect of meeting our emissions pathways. So that's a kind of scary thought. So learning and advocating is the second of my three. The third one is that many young people are employees. They're employed in businesses, and don't underestimate the ability to create influence inside a business so that it thinks about how it conducts its own business, how its supply chain embeds carbon emissions in all that is supplied to that business, and how its distribution channels emit carbon to get its produce and products to market. We need to be more focused on whole of life and global impacts, not as a way to defend what we do in a slither of the supply chain, but to understand clearly that whole of life and global impacts is ultimately the only measure that the planet will respond to. So all in all, three strong things. Now, the one I'm not allowed to say, all of you are public servants or been public servants, is you also get to vote. Choose some leaders who are prepared to help us make tough choices that will only get harder the longer we leave them. The Climate Change Commission is due to report its draft advice on emissions budgets and reduction plan on the 1st of February next year. We'll go out for public consultation, which will go on for about 6 weeks. We will gather the feedback from that consultation, go into our little huddle, and on or before the 31st of May next year, we will present to the government of the day the emissions budgets and reduction plan, and they will have 20 business days to ruminate on that before they must make that advice public. And then the government of the day, unless they change the legislation, has until the 31st of December to decide what its budgets and plan will be. Might be ours, might be a bit of ours and a bit of theirs, or it might be entirely theirs. But to the extent they don't take the advice of the Commission, there's a please explain obligation under the Act. If you're not going to do that, what are you going to do, and why have you chosen a different thing? That will hopefully create some transparency, which will help increase the certainty about where we are and what needs to be done. It is interesting, however, that the business community, particularly the big end of town, is rapidly coming on board with both the risk of being late to this party and the opportunity of being early. So that is encouraging. Local government is also pretty acutely aware that the adaptation to the impacts of climate change is going to fall squarely on their balance sheets, on their low-lying infrastructure, on infrastructure subject to inundation. And ironically, the farming community, because they live with weather and climate, are the least likely to be skeptical about climate change. They may have grave concerns about who bears the cost and what the pace of adaptation is and how much it's going to be our problem, your problem, or their problem. But all around New Zealand, when you're in your third 1-in-100-year drought in the last decade, you're beginning to think something's amiss. There are a couple of other things that the Climate Change Commission does, but they come later. One is to review the National Adaptation Plan in 6 years' time to produce the second National Risk Assessment and to provide monitoring of, once the government has adopted emissions budgets and a reduction plan, how are they going against the plan they adopted? So there are some transparency and accountability levers that go with the advice that's offered, whether taken or not. So a final kind of observation from me is sometimes we look at our friends in Australia and we think, well, they're not being very helpful. Be careful. The way emissions are counted, while it is true that the emissions that Australia has to get its coal to the port do count against Australia, the coal does not. The world chose to count on the basis of where the CO2 is emitted, and coal doesn't emit CO2 until you burn it. It is quite conceivable Australia could get to net zero before we do. Why? Solar. They have almost unlimited, almost free solar capture facing the right way. We're a long, narrow country that is challenged by solar. We're good for wind, but nobody wants to have wind turbines next to them. We've pretty much drawn down our social license to dam bodies of water. And so the challenge for New Zealand is, assume we continue to rule out nuclear, large hydro, we're challenged by turbines across the field, and we don't like solar on our neighbour's roof, and besides, we face the wrong way and there's not enough of the right stuff in the right latitude. We've got a challenge to electrify ground transportation, low temperature industrial heat, and even hydrogen is going to need to be created from electricity and water. So I suspect it won't be long before we need a Bradford-style review of how electricity is generated, distributed and priced in the middle of the 21st century. Now, I did promise I wasn't going to give a presentation, but no, there were no PowerPoint slides, so I delivered on that. However, I do get the feeling that it's your turn to explore areas of your interest by throwing me questions. So feel free.
Tony at the back, first up.
Thank you, Rod. Very interesting. Two questions, if I may. One is, I still can't work out what a ton of carbon dioxide looks like in reality. Right. So the big numbers just don't show up in my head. Mm-hmm. And the second question is, what do you think of seaweed sequestration?
Right. So let's do the carbon dioxide, because I think that's kind of cool. So you can possibly more easily imagine what a ton of coal looks like, right? Sort of a ton. How do I think about a ton? A ton of water, right, is essentially a meter by a meter by a meter of water. So think of a cube of water and it's a ton. Things that just float, so a log that floats in water is about 1 cubic meter per ton. Logs sometimes sink to the bottom, so clearly they've got a higher density, so they weigh more per cubic meter. Now you come to carbon dioxide, and then you just do the kind of atomic weight thing. If you take the coal and think of it as pure carbon, which is not quite, and you burn it, you get 7 times the weight of carbon dioxide by taking your coal and turning it into CO2 by combining it with oxygen. Now, of course, it's a gas, so it fills a bigger volume. But if you compressed that back, you would find that basically 1 ton of coal was giving rise to about 7 times that volume So it's quite a lot. That's why I keep using that analogy of the 55 billion metric tons a year of greenhouse gases is the equivalent of 600 medium-sized active volcanoes pumping this stuff up there. Don't know if that helps, but yeah, it's hard to imagine a gas and a weight. But that's that story. Now, on the seaweed sequestration, interesting. There's two things going on around seaweed. One is there a way of getting the active ingredient in seaweed that helps reduce methane emissions from ruminant livestock into their bellies so that they will continue to produce as much dairy product or whatever and not create the biogenic methane as a result of the gases in their stomachs. We already know what that active ingredient in seaweed is, and you can buy it by the barrel from China. Right? So there's nothing magical. We've understood the chemistry of what is in the seaweed, what is the active ingredient. We know how to synthesize it. We know how to create it. You can buy it by the barrel. It's really toxic. So you really want to only distribute a teeny bit of it to get the effect. And the challenge is in pastoral raised animals, how do you find a form of that ingredient that the cows will choose to eat? Turns out they don't really like it very much. That's not quite the question that you had, but it's one of the dimensions of seaweed. The next one is, well, if seaweed is taking carbon dioxide out of the air, it's not occupying land to do it. Could we carbon farm the seaweed? So long as you sequester the seaweed, I sink it to the ocean floor where it doesn't rot, then there are views about the fact you could do that. The most cost-effective carbon capture technology at the moment is growing a pine tree. It's not to say you can't capture carbon biologically in other forms, but it turns out that you've got to be prepared to pay somebody more than planting a tree.
How much progress could this country make by optimal use of the Tiwai Point electricity in carbon reduction?
So Tiwai is really interesting, and I don't claim to be an expert, but it goes the argumentation goes a bit like this. Turns out because you use carbon anodes in the smelting process, the smelter gives off about 600,000 tons a year of carbon dioxide, even although it uses hydroelectricity. You've still got the carbon anodes, which are part of making the aluminium. That's going to happen anywhere in the world, whatever your source of energy is, if you continue to use those carbon anodes. So the aluminium smelting industry has been working towards other types of anodes that don't do the carbon emissions at the point of smelting. And that technology would require the retrofit or the build again of a smelter, which is a very substantial investment. And Rio Tinto is doing some of the basic research in those alternative anode technologies. Then we come to this source of energy, because you're going to need energy to drive this thing. And the real challenge for New Zealand is we have alternative uses for that electricity to electrify ground transportation, process heat, and space heating to displace a large share of the $6 billion a year we spend buying oil from overseas. So the true cost of us smelting is arguably a large share of the oil we buy. So the idea of saying that the smelter itself is somehow this green aluminium. In the economic sense, look at the marginal use that you're making of the electricity if you didn't use it for that, and it would be the displacement of petrol oil imports once you build the infrastructure to bring the power to where you can use it. The next argument that's made is, well, if that smelter shuts, you know, China will just put up another coal snack, they'll burn coal and make aluminium. All you've done is, you know, give up our green aluminium in favor of their brown aluminium. The reality is the world is awash in aluminium at the moment, that the Chinese largely use what they produce to manufacture goods that they then sell us. They build it into products. They don't sell it as ingots on the market. but neither do they buy ingots on the market, and Rio Tinto are not about to hand China all of its aluminium clients. The alternative for Rio Tinto is to actually produce that aluminium in Canada and Iceland, where it is likely to deploy its new anode technology long before retrofitting Tiwai, and where it can get either hydropower or geothermal power at a comparable or lower price than what it's got at the moment. Rio Tinto in Canada have this amazing gig with the province of Quebec. They own the hydro power stations. They use all the power they want for making aluminium. And the province of Quebec is required to buy anything left over from them for their grid. So it's a complete flip side of what goes on here. So I think in the end, the failure of public policy was that in 2012, when Bill English said, there is no more, that's the last deal, that's the subsidy, we should have then planned and invested to bring the power north. And we just lost that 7 years. We were busy, I don't know, doing something else.
Thank you. So on the question of electricity and the efficacy of setting goal, the goal has been announced of a zero emission electricity system by 2035. And I'm concerned about the cost of that. Yeah. That there are lower, probably for that last 5% or whatever it is, there's got to be a lower cost method of reducing emissions. The reason I'm concerned about it is I vividly remember the prior Prime Minister setting a goal of 50% self-sufficiency for liquid fuels, and that drove energy policy to a very expensive petrol plant. Not that it's exact parallel, but could you comment on the efficacy of such goals, which I think tend to be political, quite frankly, the same as the zero emission by 2050. Specifically, the dry year problem is I think, being overlooked by this goal.
So the first thing is the Interim Committee on Climate Change wrote a report on electrification, and in that report it highlighted if we are going to electrify ground transportation and we're going to do the process heat and the space heating, then in orders of magnitude we need about 70% more electricity generation than we currently have in New Zealand today. That's quite a big step up. And that if that electricity generation is all going to be renewable, and we've already got, you know, 80 to 85% of the current renewable, we need to double the amount of renewable electricity if we're going to nudge towards that. Now, as they quite rightly say, that is quite challenging, because to always know that all your electricity is going to come from renewable, you've got to overbuild the renewable, because you can't rely on a grid without storage. And hydro has this amazingly cheap battery called the lake. And unless there's a new technology that will do at scale grid-based battery storage, then we will be challenged by how do we deal not with night, day, or even month to month, but year to year problems. And that's this dry year problem where, for whatever reason, the lakes in the south don't fill. And because we have environmental constraints about how far we can drain them, and even if we didn't have those constraints, there would be technology limits anyway. As a consequence of that, what are you going to do if in 2035 you've electrified all these things and it didn't rain and the snow didn't melt and the lakes didn't fill? What's now your least cost alternative? One of the arguments is keep gas. Peaker gas plants. The challenge for that is they only work if you've got a reliable supply of natural gas with a base load user of that natural gas. You've got a configuration that looks like we've got today with the Methanex taking half all the gas intake and being able to flex that half sufficiently so you can burn more gas in Huntley if you need to. The second known alternative is a bloody big pile of coal. So if you want to go least cost options, then effectively you build the big pile of coal, and if you choose to burn it, it's because you're in a dry year and you just pay the world the price of pollution. But is that an acceptable get out of jail card? That's the challenge. So the alternative is looking at these ideas of pumped hydro, where you basically use your excess electricity to raise the water to store it in a dam to let it down later, a year or two later, when you might actually have a dry year. And the contest is between one big pumped hydro lake at Onslow or a couple of smaller lakes in the North Island closer to final use, or some combination of peak of gas while we can do it. So all of that is a legitimate conversation. And some people will ask, why on earth would it cost $30 million to do a business case, right? The answer to that is, if you're about to spend $5 to $8 billion and you're going to harness your transport as well as your heating, as well as your industrial process to electricity, doing it right is worth tens of millions of dollars. So open agenda. Is the point of having targets, even if you declare them to be aspirational, risky? It can be. Because when you fall short of something you may never have thought you would achieve, others will find you wanting.
Yes.
We're hoping to get solar power in our house. And we're wondering if we should exchange our hot jazz for a link.
I will do for what I do. As a banker and fund manager, I was often asked by people, should I fix my interest rates, or should I buy those shares in that company, or should I take my money offshore? And my answer was, I'm not going to give you any advice about what you should do. It's really your cop, your call, you do what you want. But let me tell you what I've done, because that I can tell you for sure, and you can decide whether I'm an idiot. So the first thing is that our 30-year-old son decided he wanted to buy a Leaf. An old Nissan Leaf, but he works at the university and he drives past our front door every day. So he decided the gig would be, we should buy the Leaf. He would park it at home during the day so that we could charge it. And then he would walk from the university, pick up the car and take it home at night. There be dragons in that corner. That's what we did in the end, by the way. So I can declare, as the chair of the Climate Change Commission, I'm the proud owner of a 2013 Nissan Leaf that is now down to about 82% of its operating capacity. So it has about an 80-kilometer range on a single charge. So then the next part of this process was, as you know, there's not reticulated gas in the South Island, but we have a gas space heater, which is incredibly efficient, I have to say, really cool, but felt really guilty about that. And we were spending $100 a month in the winter on gas. So we went out and we asked, what would a heat pump do? Of course, the heat pump stuff is magic. It takes 1 kilowatt of electricity, makes 4 kilowatts of thermal heat. Because, you know, it's just compressing the stuff and doing the heat excess. Very clever. So then we did that. So we put in that. We didn't take out the old gas thing, you know, sort of range anxiety, except for being warm. So we kept that, but we don't use it as much. And then, of course, the big ask was solar panels. So we did all our due diligence on how many and should we have a battery, and have landed on the following. We are not going to get a battery, because it turns out that the capital cost of a battery is still way in excess of anything that you might save by not just buying some power off the grid if you run out. That the best configuration is the one where you use virtually everything you create off your roof. But here's the really interesting thing. When we got the consultants in to do it, they were fixated on payback period. So they were saying, if you buy this configuration, about $15,000 worth of panels, inverters, and da-da-da-da-da, it'll pay for itself in 6 years or something like that. Okay, 6 years. What's the expected life? Got to depreciate this stuff as well. 20 years for most of the parts of the panels and stuff, about 10 years for the inverters and other things. So, okay, so you want to get your money back over the life of the project, and then you've got your money tied up. Well, the bank's not paying you very much, so that's not going to cost you much. And so that looked something like a 12-14% per interest rate of return, right? Per annum rate of return. And I said to them, so if I had more money and the bank's only giving me 2%, how many more panels should I put up before actually I'm just generating power for the grid rather than your optimal payback period? So we've ended up with 50% more panels, and still payback period that suggests you're getting about a 6% return on your money compared to a 2% from the bank. So that's how we did the numbers. You do need roof that north faces, so only 40% of New Zealand houses even get to go past go, because if you're not north facing, you're kind of not going to get there. Interesting fun fact, Christchurch gets as many sunlight hours as Auckland, 2,000 hours a year. Nelson wins at about 2,500 hours a year. Dunedin sucks at about 1,700 hours a year. So it does matter how much sunlight you get, right? don't have a heritage north-facing roof on that's visible from the street, because you won't be able to put solar panels on it. So we've made some rules here, which mean that probably only about a third of New Zealand houses are fit for solar.
We've got a leaf and 30 kilowatt, fantastic. And then we see our friends getting 40 kilowatt, which is, so ours is
Economics, yeah. So the challenge is scale. So New Zealand has about 4 million internal combustion engine cars on the road and about 20,000 EVs and hybrids. So even if we wanted to get to 1 million EVs and hybrids by 2030, it's not entirely clear that the world is going to allocate us that number of these new vehicles. Because at the moment there is a global shortage, and the big manufacturers are all supplying into markets that pay a higher premium than we pay, and they're building brands in big markets while they can, as you know, everybody's new to this game. So if we talk to the local original equipment manufacturers and importers, they go, we just can't get head office to give us a New Zealand allocation. So our constraint here may be about how we get our hands on them, rather than purely either the infrastructure to feed the electricity or the desirability of actually owning them. They may just not come to New Zealand for another decade, and the scale that we need to make a difference.
Yeah, just one thing about biogenic carbon, could you just explain what you mean by?
Biogenic methane is a byproduct of the gut of ruminant animals decomposing the grass, and it's a burp, not a fart, right? So the farmers kind of got a quick win with the fart tax argument, but they got the wrong end of the animal, right? So the biogenic methane produced in that process is a greenhouse gas about 21 times more effective as a blanket than carbon dioxide. But it decays in the atmosphere much faster than carbon dioxide. So the argument with biogenic methane is you can reach a steady state where you're creating as much as is decaying in the atmosphere, which is why you get a non-zero for biogenic methane, assuming you stabilize your herds and flocks at a certain size. And then the challenge becomes, okay, if that's for New Zealand, so many million sheep and so many dairy cows and so many deer, how do you then reduce the biogenic methane by 24% to 47% to that level, which puts it back to where it was around about 1990. And the dairy farmers are not offering to surrender their dairy herds, and the sheep farmers are not offering to surrender their flocks. Now, the natural process of breeding and better farm management practices have led to about a 1% per annum reduction in biogenic methane production by ruminant livestock in New Zealand over the last 20 years. But almost all of that has been taken up by larger flocks and herds. So each one is less, but in aggregate there's more. And so that's a chasing your tail challenge. So how do we keep up the volume of production and get down the amount of biogenic methane? There's three possibilities here. One is breeding. There is some evidence that some animals in a flock will be better at processing grass efficiently, and you could breed for that trait. There's some evidence that what you feed the animal, the grasses they eat, may cause or reduce the biogenic methane. And there's a thought that maybe there'll be a vaccine of some sort, or some sort of, if not injection, then bolus that will produce the same thing the seaweed has, that will change the gut behavior in the ruminant animals, and that will reduce the methane emissions. So it's not without hope, but at the moment it's sort of more hope than delivery.
Sorry, your final question.
Hi, Doc. Thank you for the presentation. I got a question regarding eco-energy. I really like in Germany, for instance, after Fukushima, Angler Merkel started to remove a lot of the power plants, and that resulted in emissions actually going up in Germany. Do you think it's a good idea? Not for New Zealand, I don't think it's going to be feasible, but for maybe Australia or the United States or other countries to implement.
So my son, the one who did the deal on the leaf, is a physicist by training, and did his master's at McGill University in theoretical physics, only to say, Dad, at least I know I don't want to be a theoretical physicist. He has always made the pitch that actually the damage we do by burning fossil fuels is far greater than any damage that we have ever done to the use of nuclear power. And we are way smarter now in using nuclear power than we were in the 1960s, 70s, 80s, 90s. So the argument is, yeah, it leads to really nasty but contained and containable residues, whereas burning fossil fuels leads to this widely dispersed and uncontained pollutant. So I think you'd find in the physics community, they would say, if you can build modern day nuclear plants not near population centers, you should use them where you need energy for smelting and other high energy uses. But as you say, New Zealand might or might not buy into gene editing, probably not going to buy into nuclear power. And there are some complexities with minimum scale with current technologies.
Thank you.